As you already heard from our chair for this session, I will try to get you a little bit into the field of hyperpolarization in the next 30 minutes. This is a rather young field, and so there's a lot of development going on at the moment. I will try to cover three different techniques of hyperpolarization, and for that reason, this presentation is by no means complete. I will show you a little bit at the end a few further sessions that you should attend if you are interested in this topic. And yeah, with that, I would like to start a little bit with the motivation. So why are people interested in hyperpolarization? As we just heard, the conventional type of imaging requires a large amount of substance. So this is why typically MR imaging is done with water molecules. On the other end, we know a lot about the onset and progression of disease on the cellular level here. But the problem is to translate this knowledge into a diagnostic tool. And I have a quote here from a Science Perspective article a few years ago that says that typically a cancer, when it's detected today, it has already on average the size of about a centimeter and contains about a billion cells that are quite different in their behavior and in their response to therapy. So it would be great if we have a diagnostic tool that combines the very good anatomical imaging information from MRI with the, in principle, available intrinsic molecular information we can get from an NMR signal. Because the NMR signal is specific, we can say that it is coming from different molecules. If we can make it possible that we detect these molecules at rather low concentrations as they occur in the body let's say, a mouse study or in a patient, if you can detect these concentration levels at relative low levels, this would be a great tool, as it is given in an example here, where you can then do metabolic imaging and show the distribution of pyruvate versus the distribution of lactate. But what are the methods to get there? So as I said, in principle, NMR has the advantage over PET and SPECT that the signal information is intrinsically specific to the molecule. But the big limitation of NMR is that, as our chair just mentioned, in typical NMR, we start with a condition like this, where the overpopulation, if you work with a spin 1/2 system, the overpopulation of the ground state is just very small compared to the other spin state. And if you speak of polarization or hyperpolarization, the polarization is defined as the population difference between the two spin states normalized by the overall population of the two spin states. And it depends on this function here, hyperbolic tangent function, which has in its argument the external field B0 and the external temperature. And the aim of hyperpolarization techniques is now to get from this condition here, where we have a very small overpopulation, to a condition with an artificially increased overpopulation that gives us a tremendous enhancement in the magnetization so that we can detect things at much lower concentrations. This is a slide from the 50th ENC conference a few years ago. This was the conventional approach. If you had poor signal, well, just get more sample in your NMR spectrometer. And this is how it was done in the old days. And this is actually why conventional imaging works. We have a very small overpopulation. But as a rule of thumb, you can say that at an external field of 1.5 Tesla, only 5 in a million spins contribute at room temperature to the signal. So this is why conventional imaging works. We have a large a spin pool there that gives us finally some signal. But the aim for the hyperpolarization techniques is to get an intense specific signal with no or potentially a negligible background. So what are the methods to go there? As I said, we have this this equation here for the polarization that contains the external magnetic field B0 and the temperature. Of course, you can go to higher magnetic fields. But this typically only buys you one order of magnitude. So you can go, for example, from 3 Tesla to 9.4 Tesla or fields like this. You get a decent resolution and you increase the polarization accordingly. But the interesting thing about the hyperpolarization approach is that we artificially prepare the spin system outside the NMR magnet or the MRI scanner and artificially increase this condition here, where we now go from a polarization of 10 to the minus 5 to something like a few tens percent or even unity that can be achieved in some cases. And by this, we have an artificial enhancement of 4 to 5 orders of magnitude that then can be combined with the molecular specificity and gives us a very powerful tool. So the other method, or the other parameter that occurs in this equation, is the external temperature, just to show you that this is problematic to be used. So here you see the polarization plotted versus the external temperature. And even for high fields above 20 Tesla, the proton polarization, you would have to go far beyond below 1 Kelvin to achieve a spin polarization of 10 or 20%. Electrons, because of their larger magnetic moment, behave a little bit better. So there you can achieve already some kind of useful polarization at higher temperatures, but still not biologically relevant temperatures. And this is actually also one of the approaches that I will introduce to you in a moment, the dynamic nuclear polarization that relies on electrons. If you are stuck with room temperature because you have a living animal or a patient in your magnet, we see that around the range of room temperature, there is not a lot of change in the polarization. It is pretty poor if you work with thermal polarization. And this is why there is a tremendous effort in the NMR and MRI community to enhance the sensitivity. This is a slide that I borrowed from one of the postdocs, from Bob Griffin, who got the Laukian Prize in 2007 for the development of DNP methods. And one of the important messages to take home is that by any enhancement factor that you buy, this gives you quadratically a reduction in the acquisition time. So for example, the DNP methods they developed had an enhancement factor of 50 to 400, and that gives you a reduction in the measurement time of 2,500 to 160,000. So that means that now, with this enhanced sensitivity, you can suddenly address problems that were previously completely inaccessible because you would suffer from a tremendous long acquisition time that no biological sample could stand. So how does this translate now into clinical applications? Well, to start with, I want to introduce to you to a review article that is already 5 years old now, but I think still very interesting to those people who want to get into the field, written by several groups together. And the motivation here also was that cancer imaging still lacks the reliability in providing key biological information about the tumor in various aspects. And they motivated this research by saying that, well, MRI in principle, if you use hyperpolarized nuclei, provides information that is intrinsically not available using other molecular imaging methods. So this is why this is a very exciting field at the moment. And I will try to introduce you to three different polarization methods. All of them have in common that you first work with a highly polarized precursor, so to say, that eventually transfers its polarization or spin order onto the molecule that you are going to detect. So the first one is DNP, dynamic nuclear polarization, where we transfer the polarization from electrons with a larger magnetic moment onto other nuclei and target molecules. The second one is parahydrogen-induced polarization, which works with the spin order of parahydrogen, so molecular hydrogen, that is transferred either in a chemical reaction or in a catalyst reaction with reversible exchange onto other nuclei that are detected then. And the third one is laser-polarized noble gases. In particular, I will spend some time on laser-polarized xenon, where you use circularly polarized laser light to first polarize the electrons in an alkali metal. Typical metal here is rubidium, which then transfers its polarization in spin-spin interactions onto the noble gas nuclei. An important aspect is that for all these polarization techniques, because you just change something on the magnetic state of the spins there, the pharmacokinetic and pharmacological behavior remains completely unaffected by this. There are a few considerations in general for all of these polarization techniques. So this, we have a non-renewable starting condition, so it's artificially prepared outside the magnet. That means we have to consume our longitudinal magnetization in a careful way. There's either the so-called spin bank concept, where you do small excitations and then use up the magnetization stepwise. There's a lot going on currently in the community about the preparation of so-called long-lived states that are isolated from conventional dipolar relaxation. And another way would be that you say, okay, I have enough magnetization right away. I do a single shot readout and put all the information that I want in one excitation. Another aspect is that typically if you go away now from water and also want to detect other nuclei than protons, that these nuclei have a smaller gamma than protons, which means if you want to have comparable resolution, you need stronger gradient systems. While this might not be a typical problem because the sensitivity is that way that you work with larger pixel resolution, it at least requires that you have a dedicated RF system that works on the frequencies of these X nuclei. And of course, one important aspect in this field of hyperpolarization techniques is that time is money. So we have a non-equilibrium state. The system will eventually return with a relaxation time to its equilibrium. And you have only a certain time frame to work with these hyperpolarized nuclei, which means that you have to take into account if you prepare the state and you deliver these metabolites to a certain region, or want to see, let's say, hyperpolarized gases in the lung, you have to take this into account, how long the delivery takes, and you must do this all relatively fast. What are the targeting options? Well, DNP and FIP, historically, at the beginning, focused a lot on hyperpolarized C13. One of the very early examples was kind of single-shot angiography studies, but the focus then moved on to real-time metabolic imaging, where you give, for example, pyruvate into the animal and then see the conversion into lactate. Typically, the pyruvate, for example, has convenient long T1 relaxation times, so you have a certain amount of time to deliver the agent and to monitor the metabolism. The T2 is also sufficiently long to especially work with multi-echo techniques in this concept, and the concentrations that were used in those early studies, I will also give one clinical example later, was something like 500 micromolar in the syringe, and eventually the concentrations that were reached here were about to 20 millimolar in vivo. For the laser polarized noble gases, the most common ones are used here in this context are helium-3 and xenon-129. The historic first application was, of course, void space imaging. So here's a very early example still from the 90s with hyperpolarized helium in the lungs. So the idea was to get signal where at that time it was not possible with very short echo techniques to get any proton signal. At least the xenon also has a certain solubility in the tissue, so it goes from the lung tissue then into the bloodstream and can be detected in other organs like the brain. It is very sensitive to its molecular environment, so you can distinguish, for example, between gray matter and white matter also. And an emergent field is the study of so-called xenon biosensors, where you take the xenon signal away from the gas phase detection to build contrast agents that actually work in cells and tissue. So you trap the xenon temporarily in so-called molecular cages that can be functionalized and targeted to certain specific structures like cell surface receptors. And here the T1 relaxation, as long as the gas remains in the gas phase, can be relatively long, up to several days. So you can store it and then use it later. As soon as it is introduced into the organism, the T1 shortens, and you also have to be fast, as with the other ones. Concentrations here, for example, 30% by volume in the lungs when it is inhaled by the patients. The concentrations that are achieved in the tissue, in the brain, for example, in the micromolar range. So now a little bit more into the details of the three different techniques. For DNP, one works with a medium that is doped with a single electron substance, for example, an organic free radical that is frozen to low temperature, where you then have a rather decent polarization from the electrons. And by applying a microwave experiment then, so irradiating on with microwave frequency onto the frozen sample, you transfer the polarization from the electrons onto other nuclei that are close enough to them. A lot of these studies are done with C13, but it also works with other nuclei. And then you have to thaw the solution, remove or neutralize the radical, and can inject it then into the object of interest. As I said, the idea is that the electrons have a larger magnetic moment that allows it already at temperatures between 1 and 10 Kelvin in this frozen solution to achieve a polarization that is then transferred in a microwave experiment where you, for example, do a double spin flip. So you go from this ground state here and flip both the electron and the nuclear spin of the adjacent nuclei from pyruvate, for example. Then the electron state relaxes relatively fast, or it remains in this experiment and is in a net reaction, so to say, a spin flip of the nucleus. So you achieve a decent polarization in this context. On the order, you pump the system with microwaves for about up to an hour and then achieve a polarization of tens of percent. And the typical applications, as I mentioned already, are metabolic studies where you administer hyperpolarized pyruvate and then observe the conversion into lactate and alanine, for example, but also the pH-dependent conversion between CO2 and bicarbonate. Here are typical examples also from this review that I mentioned earlier on. So you administer pyruvate and then see these metabolic conversions into lactate and the other two ones here. There's an increasing number of actually C13 labeled tracers, so to say, available now. They all address different mechanisms, for example, like lactate dehydrogenase. I brought you one example here from an early animal study that I found was kind of intriguing, where it showed that on the conventional anatomical imaging, so this is a treatment of glioblastoma in a rat with temozolomide. In the conventional anatomical imaging, you don't see a shrinkage of the tumor until day 5 to 7. So here are in dark gray on the bottom here, the treated animals, where there is first a kind of stop in the growth of the tumor, and then there is a decrease in the tumor volume, whereas the untreated animals increase still in tumor volume. But on the metabolic imaging, when you monitor the lactate to pyruvate ratio, you see that already from day one on, there is a difference in the metabolic behavior there, where you can see that there is a response to the treatment. The famous first inpatient study in this field was published in 2013 on prostate cancer patients, where it was also very nicely shown that there is a very distinct difference in the prostate cancer C13 spectra between the cancerous tissue here on one side of the prostate and the normal tissue on the contralateral side, the level of hyperpolarized C13, and the flux of the signal from pyruvate to lactate is increased during the cancer progression and decreases after therapy. Critical also in this study was to point out that you have to be fast to do this. So from the agent in the polarizer at the low temperature of about 1 Kelvin into putting the agent into the patient and doing the imaging study, it's just barely more than 1 minute of time that is happening here. So you have to be fast to keep the polarization and do something useful with it. Interesting outcome here was that as one example shown there on the proton images, there was a suspicious side only on one side of the prostate, whereas the metabolic imaging was applied to both sides of the prostate. And on the contralateral side, there was also a suspicious area of increased lactate to pyruvate ratio, which could later be confirmed by his histology. So also an example where the metabolic information gives us something that is very useful and shows an early detection of the disease or therapy monitoring, as like in the other case, much more sensitive than conventional imaging. A recent interesting aspect here is that people are still working on techniques how to get rid of the radical that is in there, because that's nothing that you want to have in vivo. There was one recent study where they worked with long UV irradiation of a neat solution of pyruvate to generate radicals directly from the pyruvate, and then they could already do metabolic imaging in a normal DNP study, then also displaying the pyruvate and lactate distribution in a rat. So that is an active field of research at the moment, what to do with these radicals. For the parahydrogen probes, one works with the principle that parahydrogen as a molecule, or hydrogen as a molecule, has two spins that can align in different orientations to each other, and one of these spin configurations is parahydrogen, where we have a high spin order that per se doesn't carry an NMR signal, then it's a spin zero, but the first studies were working then with a hydrogenation reaction where this H2 molecule is transferred as a unit onto a target molecule that at the beginning has an unsaturated bond and then is hydrogenated. And then because of an adjacent other nucleus like C13 here, the symmetry of these two protons is broken and you eventually convert the spin order into detectable magnetization. You can do this in different conditions, either in a high field or in a low field. The common idea is that you use the increased spin order of the parahydrogen outside the magnet and then artificially increase the populations of two of the states in this coupled spin system to eventually actually detect magnetization. An early example here was this molecule that had two functions. One, of course, here and at this time still the unsaturated bond that was used for the hydrogenation, and a lipophilic motif which could bind into atherosclerotic plaques. They showed in this animal study with an LDL receptor deficient mice that was building up large atherosclerotic plaques that these molecules here then bind into this plaque and give a decent signal shift here. So this is the unbound molecule, hyperpolarized. This is the bound one in the lipid environment. And here the imaging experiment was a very coarse resolution at that time, but in principle they could show that this modality should work. Also here, a more recent example of something that I thought was very exciting going on there at the moment is that you don't need this hydrogenation reaction anymore. There is a method called SABR, signal amplification by reverse exchange, where on an iridium catalyst, both the parahydrogen coordinate together with a target molecule, and then you transfer a spin order in principle from the parahydrogen that is reversibly bound here onto the target molecule. And this is a work done by the Warren group, where they could show that depending on in which conditions you do this, either at in a shielded condition at low field, you can produce detectable magnetization, or if you do this just in the stray field of the magnet and then transfer it into the magnet, you can actually produce a singlet order that kind of saves you the hyperpolarization then for later on. And when you transfer it, it actually is converted into detectable magnetization, and they could show that whereas the T1 lifetime of the magnetization produced in the shielded field is only 6 minutes, the lifetime of the singlet order is something like 23 minutes. So this buys you some time to actually prepare your sample, and these diazerine units could be incorporated into various molecules and then used in biological studies there. The third method that I want to introduce to you is hyperpolarized xenon. So in this context, we, as I already mentioned, we work with a strong laser. This laser here is illuminating a glass cell that contains the rubidium vapor seen in green here, exposed to an external magnetic field. And this allows us to selectively pump one spin transition in the system while we continuously deplete one of the spin states of the rubidium electrons. We kind of overpopulate another one, and then in a spin exchange reaction, the xenon gas is just flowing through this pumping cell. We get a tremendous signal enhancement. So there is in black here the hyperpolarized signal, whereas the thermally polarized signal just disappears in the noise as this red line here. The typical application was, as I already mentioned earlier, the void space imaging, which was combined also in one study by Warren's group a while ago, with a targeted contrast agent that had a magnetic, a superparamagnetic iron oxide nanoparticle here that could bind to metastatic cancer cells and then induce a kind of signal loss here also at fairly low concentrations. So there were only a few of these metastatic cells where you can then induce this void signal there. But another interesting approach is this work of xenon biosensors, originally developed in the Pines and Wemmer lab in Berkeley, where the idea is to trap the hyperpolarized nuclei in a molecular cage for some time. And this cage is kind of can have a targeting unit that can bind to a specific molecular target. And this can now be combined with a CESS method that we heard from the first speaker in this session, because the xenon is not permanently bound in this cage here. So there's continuous exchange going in and out of xenon going in and out of this cage, and you can detect two different signals. The xenon in the cage gives you a signal at roughly 65 ppm chemical shift, and the xenon outside the cage roughly at 190 ppm. And by kind of saturating here on this very small signal from the xenon inside the cage and detecting the other one, you can then further amplify the signal quite a bit. So the typical example here is that you have a study, for example, here with two different solutions. Only one of them contains the xenon host. You do a reference image, then you apply a saturation pulse, and you get a void signal here, and then you do the saturation, the difference of the two images, and that tells you the area where these exchanging hosts for xenon are. One should mention that CESS is no hyperpolarization. Sometimes people say because it's an amplification, it's a hyperpolarization. That's not true. In fact, we actually destroy the hyperpolarization here with the saturation pulse. As our first speaker mentioned earlier on, the nice thing is that it is a switchable contrast. So by sweeping through the saturation frequency, we can address different solvents with different chemical shifts here. which is an advantage over other contrasts that work with a signal destruction like iron oxide nanoparticles, where you, sometimes it's not really clear if there is lower signal because the contrast agent is there or because of other reasons. The other advantage of using the xenon for the CEST experiment is that xenon is very sensitive to its molecular environment, so it comes for free with all the advantages that you have from para-CEST agents. Here, for example, we could distinguish between these biosensors that are associated with cells compared to free biosensor outside the cell. So this is one of the, it's also a Z-spectrum as introduced in the CEST talk earlier, where you saturate at different frequencies and there are two distinct resonances to be detected. You can do this at the moment on the cell biology level, so you can label cells with these biosensors when they are not targeted, so you just use a cage, for example, maybe with a fluorescein, to also do some fluorescein imaging and embed them in alginate beads and then detect, okay, there is one volume that carried the labeled cage. A more recent application is based on the idea of metabolic oligosaccharide engineering, which was a big success story in fluorescence imaging. So the idea is that you introduce to your target cells a modified sugar that bears an azide group, and just through the normal glycobiosynthesis of the cell, this azide group doesn't do any difference to this chemistry going on there. So the sugar is incorporated into the glycan structure, and then this azide group is selectively reactive to a bio-orthogonal group that carries also the cage as a xenon host, and then under physiological conditions, there is a chemical reaction going on where this partner here binds eventually to the azide group, and you have chemically labeled the sugar structure of the cell surface. So here's an example where we had one cell population that was exposed to this specifically modified sugar, mannose in this case, and a control group of cells that just saw the biosensor but couldn't do the chemical click reaction. And of as we were hoping for, you can see the assessed contrast between these two different populations. And the labeling concentration here, the difference was only 80 nanomolar in between the two cell populations. So fairly low compared to roughly 3 to 4 orders more contrast agent you would need for a gadolinium contrast agent. Where is this field going? So we thought, of course, it's kind of only the first step to have one cage unit here per targeting unit. There was a study published 2 years ago by Mikhail Shapiro where they use bacteria gas vesicles, for example, from cyanobacteria that can host thousands of these xenon atoms instead of one individual one. And we currently achieve here images at fairly low concentration in the picomolar range. This is the control image. This is the saturation image. You barely see it here. If I turn it on now, you might see also in the projection that one part starts blinking. This is the difference between the on and off resonance. If you do the difference image, you actually see that the core, the center volume was the one that carried these gas vesicles at 70 picomolar concentrations. And this was detected with 300 micrometer resolution in 18 minutes. The conventional detection time for those low concentrations would be something like 300 million years. So it would just explode in your measurement time if you go to these picomolar concentrations. So to summarize, I would also like, again, to use a quote from this review that I started with, where it said in 2011 that hyperpolarization technology is still in its infancy and current polarizer equipment and methods are suboptimal. I think there has a lot been going on in the recent years, but it's still a very active field, very interdisciplinary, to do something on the lifetime of the polarization, to increase the number of potential tracers that we have, also to go with some of the techniques into the first in vivo studies. And as they concluded in that review at that time, nevertheless, there are no fundamental barriers that preclude us from a rapid translation of this exciting technology to clinical research and perhaps clinical care. And I also personally think it's a very exciting field because it brings together physicists, chemists, biologists, and the clinical side to develop new techniques, in this example here for cancer, but also for other diseases in principle. And with that, I would like to thank you for attention. And here's a list that I put together with further sessions on hyperpolarization coming up this week. So there are different formats like educational sessions and plenary sessions. Thank you for attention.